Hello friends, I hope all of you are doing great. And this is the second lecture of the module one of the course Analog Electronics. And we will have a look at the BJT, that is the bipolar junction transistor, and its physical operation in today's session. Okay. Though the physical description physical operation is of importance is this physical description provides a considerable insight regarding the performance of the transistor transistor and its elements, and we will also describe on the current flow, okay, in terms of electrons and holes to the transistor terminal, and we will also look into the transistor terminal characteristics, and we will also get a short introduction into the circuit models for transistor operations in different modes, and we will also see how this can help us in analysis and design of the transistor circuits. Okay. Why this is important is because you need to have a high degree of familiarity with the bipolar junction transistor, because this lays a foundation for the use of the bipolar junction transistors and amplifier designs. Okay, so let's start with the second session. So we have the set of objectives for the second session. So let's see why, as I said in the first session, that MOSFETs are predominantly, or CMOS technologies are predominantly used compared to the BJT. Okay. But still, then why BJT we need to discuss. And then we will also see the device structure and physical operation. And we will have an introduction to the transistor operating modes. What are the different currents that flow into the transistor, like the collector current, the emitter current, the base current, and their relationship with each other. And we will also see the operation of the NPN transistor in the active mode. So why bipolar junction transistor? Okay, as we already know that bipolar transistors has nearly enjoyed 3 decades of, it's been a device choice for approximately 3 decades, and both for in the design of discrete and integrated circuit. And although MOSFETs had been known very early it was not until 1970 and 1980 that it became a very serious competitor to BJT. Okay, and by 2015, the MOSFETs was undoubtedly widely used electronic. I mean, it was widely used transistor in the electronic devices. And CMOS technology was the technology of choice in the design of the integrated circuit. But nevertheless, bipolar junction transistors or BJTs remain a significant device that excels in certain applications. So the BJT still remains popular in discrete circuit designs, where it is used together with other components such as the resistors or capacitors, and also to implement circuits that are assembled on the PCBs or the printed circuit boards that we call. Okay, and here we note the availability of a very wide selection of BJT type that fit every conceivable application, as well as the BJT is still the preferred device in some very demanding analog and digital integrated circuit applications. And this is especially true in very high frequency and high speed circuit devices. Okay, and in particular, a very high speed digital logic circuit family based on the BJTs, say namely the emitter coupled, okay, emitter coupled logic is still in use. And bipolar junction transistor can be combined with the MOSFETs to create innovative circuits that takes an advantage of the high input impedance and low power operating low power operation of the MOSFETs, and the very high frequency operation and high current driving capability of the bipolar transistor or the transistor MOSFETs. This resulting technology is known as, that is, you are combining the MOSFET and a very high frequency operation and high current driving capability of the bipolar transistor. The resulting technology is known as the bipolar complementary MOS, that is the BiC MOS. In short, it is called as the BiC MOS, and it is finding increasing number of applications or larger area of applications. You can find the combination of the BJT and MOSFETs. Okay, so to answer few of your questions, like why BJT. So you may be wondering why BJT, what's the competitor and who are the competitors for BJT and bipolar technology. So MOSFET in particular, the CMOS is the leading competitor. And what is the advantage or what advantages that the competition has over, or the competitor has over BJT, is the small size. Okay, the die area is very small. And again, the low cost and low power dissipation. Okay, so what are the advantages, or what advantages does BJT and bipolar have over the MOSFET is the high frequency operation. Okay, that's why they combine the two technologies and they come up with BiCMOS. Okay, that is the high frequency operation, high current drive, high reliability in severe environmental conditions. Okay, and the last question that you would be interested is to know what circuit applications benefit from BJT and bipolar technology. Okay, the RF analog and digital circuits, power electronics and power amplifiers, automobile electronics, radiation hardened electronics. So these are some of the major areas where the BJT or bipolar technologies fit into. Okay, so now let's see, or let's get a brief introduction on the physical structure, okay, of the bipolar junction transistor. Okay, so this is the device structure for the bipolar transistor, and as I already mentioned in the last session, okay, so bipolar junction transistor is a three-layer device, right? It consists of three semiconductor region. What are they? The emitter region, the base region, and the collector region. Okay, so if you see structure here, you have the emitter region and collector region are of N type, and you have the base region, which is of the P type. Okay, which is of the P type. Okay, and such a transistor is called as an NPN transistor. Okay, and this is the symbolic representation of an NPN transistor, and this is the physical structure of practically how the transistor is actually implemented, or how in real world scenario how exactly it looks up. Okay, so again, it a dual or I mean a p-type transistor will have two p regions. Okay, an emitter region is also p type and collector region is also p type, and you have a p type base region, I mean, I'm sorry, n type base region. Okay, So the terminal is connected to each of the three semiconductor regions of the transistor. So here it is labeled as E, okay, which is emitter. Then you have B, which is the base. And then you have the C, which is the collector. So the transistor consists of two PN junctions, the emitter, okay. So it has two PN junctions, the emitter base junction, okay, the emitter base junction and the collector base junction. So depending on the bias condition, okay, so what is the bias? It can be forward biased, okay. So one of the region has to be forward biased, one of the region has to be reverse biased, okay, for the amplification and application, okay. So the emitter base junction and the collector base junction. So depending on the bias condition, forward or reverse bias of each of the junction, the operating modes of the BJT is defined. So basically they operate in three different modes: the active mode, the saturation mode, and the cutoff mode. Okay, we will discuss about the three modes in the following slides. Okay, now let's see about the construction of the BJT. Okay, so a BJT is a three-terminal semiconductor device, and why it is called as the bipolar is, as I said, it is taken, or the term bipolar is taken from the truth that this kind of a transistor includes two kinds of semiconductor material, like the p-type, that is the positive type, and the n-type, that is the negative type, where the current flow from these regions. Usually these transistors include silicon. So the construction of a BJT will define its working characteristics, as I said, right? So the construction of a BJT can be done through three doped semiconductor sections, which are separated through two PN junctions. So the transistor includes three layers, namely the base, the emitter, and the collector. So these transistors are available in two types, namely the NPN and the PNP, and the physical structure of the NPN is what is shown in the slide here. Okay, so in NPN, it includes two N regions separated by one P region, wherein in PNP, it includes two P region and separated by one N region. So in BJT, the term bipolar refers to the utilization of both the utilization of both the charge carriers, like the electrons and the holes within the structure. Okay, so when PN junction connects the base and the emitter region, then it is known as the base emitter region or the emitter based region. And similarly, once the PN junction connects the base and the collector region, then it is known as the base collector region or the collector base region. So a wire lead unites, okay, a wire lead unites every region, and this leads are branded with the E, B, and C. Okay, so you see here B, what you see here E, this is the wire lead. Okay, so E, B, and C. So the base region is slightly doped. Okay, this is the base region. So it is slightly doped, and it is extremely thin compared to, okay. So if you see, it is extremely thin compared to the other two regions. Okay. And it is extremely thin in comparison to the emitter terminal, that is heavily doped, and somewhat doped is the collector region. Okay, and we also see the schematic symbol of NPN, and we see for the emitter terminal there is an arrow. Okay, so this arrow basically represents, okay, the symbol of the arrow, or the arrow symbol on the emitter terminal is always there, and the arrow direction represents the current flow to the current flow because of the charge carriers. Okay, And here we have, the electrons as the charge carriers, because it is the NPN connection, okay? I mean, or the NPN configuration. And if it is a PNP structure, then holes are the charge carriers, okay? That is the basic difference between, and again, the arrow is pointed inward in case of the PNP transistor, okay? You will see, I have the symbol is shown in the next following slide. Okay, so the emitter terminal emits the charge carriers, like it can be holes or it can be electrons, as I said, to the other two terminals. So which are the other two terminals? You have the base and the collector. So the base terminal is always reverse biased with respect to the other terminal, like the emitter, so that it can produce huge majority carriers. So in BJT, the emitter is mostly heavily doped region. The emitter base junction must be connected in the forward biasing mode or in the forwarding bias state within both the transistors, like it can be NPN or it can be the PNP. Okay, so the emitter terminal provides electrons towards the electron base junction within the NPN transistor, whereas it supplies charge carriers like the holes to the same junction within the PNP transistor. So collector terminal, the part on the reverse side, okay, the other side of the emitter, okay, on the other side of the emitter, will collect the emitter charge carriers, called as the collector. So this terminal is heavily doped. However, the doping level of this terminal is among the base terminal, which is lightly doped and heavily doped emitter terminal. So the collector base junction must be reverse biased in both the transistors. The main reason for this biasing is to eliminate the charge carriers from the collector base junction. The collector terminal of an NPN transistor is to collect electrons and that are emitted through the emitter terminal, whereas the NPN for a PNP transistor, it gathers the holes that are emitted through the emitter terminal. Okay, so the distinction for a PNP is the arrow, symbolically the arrow is inwards. Okay, here in the NPN it is showing outward arrow, for the PNP it is an inward arrow. Okay. The base terminal, okay, the base terminal is the center part among the collector and the emitter terminal, which forms the PN junction among them. So the base terminal is most lightly doped segment in the transistor, and so being the central part of the BJT, it will allow it to manage the charge carriers flow among the emitter and the collector terminal. The base emitter junction shows high resistance, as it as this junction can be connected in the reverse bias. Okay, and the bipolar junction consists of two back-to-back. So in summary, if I have to tell, bipolar junction transistor consists of two back-to-back PN junction. Both electrons and holes participate in the conduction process of the bipolar device. And BJT basically is a current controlled current source, okay, or a current controlled current device. And it is widely used in discrete circuits and IC designs for both analog as well as for digital circuits, okay. And if we have to talk about the doping, as I said, the doping concentrations, okay, the collector doping is usually or approximately equal to 10^9, and base doping is slightly higher in the range. So it is anywhere between 10^10 to 10^11, and emitter doping is much higher. So it is approximately 10^17. Okay, and the NPN transistor comes with a three-layer it's a three-layer device, and two N-doped layer and a P-doped layer. The P-doped layer is sandwiched between, or say in case of a PNP transistor, the N-type is sandwiched between the two p-type regions. Okay, and in an NPN transistor, the conduction is carried by both the charge carriers, like the as I said, the electrons and as well as the holes, right? However, electrons are majority charge carriers in a PNP. Majority charge carriers in a NPN transistor, and similarly in case of a PNP transistor, it also comes as a three layer device, or a three terminals, and it has two p doped layer and one n doped layer, right? And the n doped layer exists between the two p doped layers, and actually n doped layer is responsible for triggering the transistor action. So when a proper bias voltage is applied at the p doped layer, it draws current which is then used to control the large current at the other terminals. A transistor that come in NPN and PNP configuration are nothing but the combination of two diodes that are joined back to back, right? Because it is transistor is a three layer device, diode is a two layer device, and you are adding an extra layer here, right? And so it is very similar to connecting two PN junction back to back, okay? And in a NPN transistor, current flows from the collector to the emitter, while in PNP transistor, current flows from emitter to the collector. The current direction to the the voltage polarity, okay? The current direction and the voltage polarity are always opposite in both of the transistors. Suppose if a current is flowing in the clockwise direction in an NPN transistor and comes with a positive polarity, comes with a positive polarity at the base terminal, it will flow in the anti-clockwise direction in the PNP transistor, where voltage polarity becomes negative, okay? And because there the holes are the majority, because holes are the majority carriers here for a PNP, right? And a PN junction formed between the two semiconductor material is the major building block of the transistor. And when the PN junction is formed, major charge carriers in the N region, that is the electrons, okay, cross the junction and reaches the P region, where they recombine with the holes. Similarly, major charge carriers in the P region are the holes, and they cross the junction and reach the N region, right, where they recombine with the electrons. Okay, remember that when a PN junction is formed, the major charge carriers in the N region are the electrons. They cross over to reach the P region, where they recombine with the holes, and similarly, major charge carriers in the P region are the holes. They cross the junction and reach the N region, where they recombine with the electrons. So the diffusion of electrons and the holes depends on the biasing voltage applied across the junction. Okay, what are the junction? It is the emitter base junction or the collector base junction. Okay, and emitter base junction is forward bias, collector base junction should be reverse bias. So the voltage is said to be forward bias when the P region is connected with the positive terminal and of the battery, and the N region is connected to the negative terminal of the battery. Okay, and under the forward bias condition, the holes and electrons can easily cross the junction and maintain a current across the junction. So when this diffusion occurs, it will generate the region across the junction, which is depleted with major charge carriers. The region is known as the depletion region. Okay, so as long as the forward bias voltage is applied, current flows across the junction, the diffusion of holes and the electrons create an electric field within the junction. So this electric field resists the further diffusion of the charge carriers. As said earlier, the transistor comes with two PN junction, where one junction is to be forward biased and the other junction is to be reverse biased. Okay, so the voltage applied and the current direction for a NPN is a positive voltage is given to the collector current terminal to produce a current flow from the collector to emitter, and a positive for a PNP transistor, a positive voltage is given to the emitter terminal to produce a current flow from the emitter to the collector. Okay, so VCE, the collector to emitter voltage, will be positive in case of an NPN transistor and negative in case of a PNP transistor. Okay, so now let's get an introduction, or let's understand about the different modes, transistor modes of operation. Okay, so majorly the transistor comes with different modes of operation. Okay, and so let's discuss each one of them one by one. So what are the three different modes, or what are the modes? You have three modes. One is the active mode, the cutoff mode, and the saturation mode. Okay, so active mode is used for amplification of electronic signals, where a small current at the base terminal is being amplified at the collector terminal. Okay, and the base terminal is responsible for the transistor action, which controls the number of main charge carriers. Okay, what are the main charge carriers for an NPN configuration? Electrons. For a PNP, it is the hole. Right. I hope it's clear. Following through it and draws a very small current when a proper bias voltage is applied. Okay, what is a proper bias voltage? That is your VC. That is voltage across the collector should be greater than the voltage across the base. That should be greater than the voltage across the emitter. Okay, VC greater than VB greater than VE. Okay, so this is the active mode. Okay, or this is called as the active mode. Okay, when you maintain VC greater than VB greater than VE, you are in the active mode of operation, and it is also called as the forward active mode. So the transistor in active mode operate as an amplifier, right? As I said, for analog circuit, the application is amplifier circuits. For digital circuits, it is used as a switch. And then it also provides a flat region of operation. So when it has to perform signal amplification, the characteristics of the curve should be such that you should have it should operate in the stable area, or the stability of area, where it is a flat region curve, where there is no loss of signal, and even the noise tolerance is in the permittable level. Okay, and it is again large signal gain. Okay, in this area you have a very large signal gain, and the distortions are also very small. Okay, and then we have the cutoff region. So this mode, the transistor works as an open switch, and the current flow across the terminal, where a bias voltage is less than the voltage at the, the base voltage, I'm sorry, not the bias, it's a base voltage is less than the voltage at the collector terminal or at the emitter terminal. That is your VC is greater than VB. And similarly, VE is also greater than VB. Okay, so that is the cutoff mode. So transistor is used as a switch, and cutoff is equivalent to off state. Okay, in for a digital circuit, cutoff is equivalent to off state, and in digital circuits, off state also it also means that it is a zero state. And when you have a zero state, when the current is very low and the high voltage is very high. Okay, and then you have the saturation. The third region of for the transistor mode of operation is the saturation mode. So in this mode, this mode is considered as the on state, or the on switch, where current flows freely from collector to the emitter. So in this condition, the voltage difference between the collector and the emitter is zero, and the collector current is restricted by a supply voltage and the load resistance. Okay, and in saturation mode, both junctions are forward biased, and base voltage is greater than the voltage at the collector terminal or the emitter terminal. Okay, that means VB, base voltage is VB, represented by VB, and VB is greater than both VC as well as VE. Okay, the collector voltage or the emitter voltage. Okay, so apart from these three modes, we also have another mode called as the reverse. Okay, so in saturation mode, the transistor is used as a switch. Saturation is equivalent to on state, and in digital circuits, on state means one state, I mean a logic high or a logic one. Okay, and when you are in logic one, your current flow is high and you have a low voltage. Okay, low voltage condition. Okay, so apart from the three modes, we also have another mode called as the reverse active mode. Okay, which is less frequently used. Okay, so this mode acts as an active, I mean here in this, I mean this mode also act as an active mode with one exception, that the current direction is reversed here. Okay, so the current flow from the emitter to collector here, okay, which is proportional to the, this current is proportional to the base current, and the base current is highly influenced by the bias voltage applied at the terminal, which is then controlled. Okay, the voltage which is then controlled by large current at the base terminal and the emitter terminal. So the voltage at the terminal is related, say VC is less than VB, which is less than VE. Okay, so the collector voltage is less than, because negative current flow, it is flowing in the reverse direction. So it is VC is less than VB, that is less than emitter voltage, VE. Okay, so the active region, so among the three, active region is the most widely used for analog circuits. Okay, so now let's move on to so this represents the different junction voltages for a typical NPN transistor at 25 degree centigrade. So if the material is silicon, then VCE sat is 0.2, VBE sat is 0.8, VBE active is 0.7. okay, sat means saturation, active is active in active mode, and cut in and cut off is in the cutoff mode. Okay, so it is 0.5, and VBE cutoff is 0.0 for silicon. And if the material is germanium, then we have the material used is germanium, then VCE sat is 0.1, VBE sat is 0.3, VBE active is 0.2, and VBE cut in is 0.1, and VBE cutoff is minus 0.1. Okay, and basically these values are approximately for a NPN transistor which is operating at 25, or typically operating at the entries of the table are appropriate for a NPN transistor which is typically operating at 25 degree centigrade, or the temperature these are the different conditions, such as the active, saturation, and cutoff, and these represents the junction voltages. Okay, and for a NPN, for a PNP transistor, the signs can be the value, the sign of all the values can be negative. Okay, it should be a reverse. Okay, say this becomes for a germanium, this is minus, VC sat is minus 0.1, VBE sat is minus 0.3, VBE active is minus 0.2, VBE cut in is minus 0.1, VBE cutoff is plus 0.1. Okay, so that is the junction voltages for a typical NPN transistor. Okay, so depending on the external bias, the polarities can be defined. Okay, and see what are the different configurations in which the BJT transistors can be connected, or what are the different types of configurations that can be the circuits can be connected in case of the BJT transistors. So the transistor can be connected in a circuit in one of the three configuration modes. It can be either the common base configuration, or it can be the common emitter configuration, okay, where in common base is common, are connected to the ground. In common emitter is connected to the ground, and the input is between the base and emitter, and output is taken between collector and emitter. And the third configuration is common collector, where the input is given is common collector, collector terminal. So you have the input between VBE and output taken from across emitter to ground. Okay. Let's try to understand what are the difference between the three configurations. Okay. So in common base configuration of the transistor, the base terminal is common among the input and the output signal. So here in the common base, the base terminal is common, as I said, is common between the input and the output signal. So the input signal can be given among the two terminal like the base as well as the emitter, whereas the output can be obtained among the two terminals like the base, and the collector. Okay. And the collector terminal, the output signal is low at the collector terminal. The output signal is low as compared to the input signal at the emitter terminal. So thus its gain is less than one for a common base configuration, or the gain of the circuit is one. So it attenuates the signal. Okay. So this output output of this configuration is non-inverting. So both input as well as the is non-inverting. So both input as well as the output signal will be in phase. Okay. And this common base configuration is not commonly used due to its high voltage gain. And because of its extremely high frequency response, this kind of configuration is used only for a single phase amplifiers. Okay. And this one phase or single phase amplifier can be used like in cases of RF amplifiers and microphone pre-amplifiers circuits. Okay. And the next configuration is the common emitter. Okay, so in this configuration, as you see, the emitter terminal is common among the input and the output. The input is given among the terminals, base and among the two terminals, base and the emitter, whereas output can be obtained among the collector and the emitter terminal. So it can be it can simply be identified through observing the circuit. So when the emitter terminal is connected to the ground, then input and output are obtained from the base and the collector terminals. Okay. And the common emitter configuration includes the maximum current and power gain between the among the three configurations. Okay. That is among the CB and CC, this has the includes maximum current and power gains. Okay. And the main reason what is the reason for this, or what is the main reason, is because the input because of the input at the junction of the forwarding bias. So its input impedance is extremely less, whereas the output can be received from the reverse bias junction. Thus its output impedance is extremely high, and in common emitter configuration, the emitter current is equivalent to the amount of base current and the collector current, that is IE will be equal to IC plus IB. Okay. So this configuration has, emitter current is the sum of the base current and the collector current. Okay. And that's what it means. So this configuration has a maximum current gain like IC by IB, or the ratio of a collector current by base current, because of the load resistance. Because the load resistance can be connected with the series through the collector terminal, it is also observed that a small increase with the base current will affect in a very high current at the output region. So this common emitter configuration works like an inverting amplifier, where wherever the output signal is totally opposite within the polarity towards the input signal. Okay, thus the output signal can be shifted at 180 degree with respect to the can be shifted by 180 degree with respect to its input signal. Okay, and the common the third configuration is the common collector configuration. And in common collector configuration, it is also called as the emitter follower or the voltage follower circuit. Okay, so this that includes a collector. The collector is grounded here. Okay, and the connection of the collector terminal can be can be done to ground towards the supply. So for both input and output, the collector terminal is common. The output is obtained from the emitter through the load, which is connected in series, whereas the input is provided towards the base terminal directly. This configuration includes high input as well as output impedance. So the this permits it to execute like an impedance matcher. So thus, this kind of configuration is extremely useful within the impedance matching methods, okay, or impedance matching circuits. Okay, so this is about common the BJT configurations, and we will also discuss the characteristics, okay, in detail in the following sessions. Okay, how for a common emitter, how the output characteristics appear in the cutoff region or in the active region or saturation region. Say, for example, if I have to tell it for a common base configuration in active region, if the transistor, the output characteristics, its curve will be taken between the collector current IC and the collector base voltage VCB at constant emitter current IE. Okay, so for so in the active region of operation, the emitter base junction will be forward biased, and the collector base junction will be reverse biased. So in this region, the collector current will be approximately equal to the emitter current, and the transistor works as an amplifier. And in the active region, the collector current is essentially almost a constant. Okay, and the collector current IC is also independent of the collector base voltage, and the transistor can be set to work as a constant current source, and this provides very high dynamic output resistance. And in saturation region, the emitter base junction and the collector base junction both are forward biased, and hence IC becomes independent of IB. Okay, and in cutoff region, the region is below the curve of IE equal to zero, and it is known as the cutoff, okay, zero, logic zero state, where the collector current is nearly zero and the collector base and the emitter base junctions of the transistor are reverse biased. Okay, so the so now let's move on to, okay, so if we have to see, the common base configuration has a high in common base configuration, it has a high voltage gain but no current gain. And in for common emitter configuration, it has both current as well as voltage gain. And for common collector configuration, it has current gain but no voltage gain. Okay, so this is the symbolic representation for the three connections. Okay, so here we are comparing. Let's see the difference in common base, common emitter, and common collector. And these are some of the characteristics, how they differ. The input impedance. So in case of a common base, it is very low. It lies between the value 50 ohm to 200 ohm. And for common emitter, it is medium. It lies between a value 500 ohms to 2 kilo ohms. And for common collector, it is high. Okay, for again, similarly, the output impedance is very high for common base and high also for common emitter, whereas it is very low for the output impedance is low for common collector. And phase angle is for common base and common collector, it is there is no phase change, 0 degree. And for common emitter, it is 180 degree. And voltage gain is high in case of common base, low in case of common emitter. and I'm sorry, high in case of common base, medium in case of common emitter, and low in case of common collector. And current gain is again low for common base, medium for common emitter, and high for common collector. And power gain is again very high in case of common emitter, and medium in case of collector, and low in case of common base. The leakage current again is very small in case of common base, whereas very large in case of your common emitter and common collector mode. And preferable application areas are common base used in pre-amplifier circuits for your microphones, and common emitter, the application area is audio amplifiers, and for common collector, it is impedance matching. Okay, so now let's try to understand or in detail see the operation of an NPN transistor in the active mode. Okay, so as I said, this is the physical or the structure, physical structure of the NPN transistor is as shown. So as I said, for an NPN, so there is a movement of the electrons. Okay, so the electrons gets injected, okay, from the n-type regions, and from the p-type region, the holes try to get injected, right? Okay, so the forward, and I also told that the emitter base junction is forward biased, collector base junction is reverse biased, okay? And we represent the emitter base junction as JE and collector base junction as JC, okay? And the current through the E terminal or the emitter terminal is IE, and the current entering the base is IB, and the current entering collector terminal is IC. Okay. Yeah. And you also have to remember that the transistor means transfer of resistor. Okay. Or transfer of resistance. Okay. So when in active mode, your forward bias, that is J emitter base junction is forward and collector base junction is reverse bias. So RE, so your transfer of resistor R to R, okay? So the forward bias of the emitter base junction will cause the current to flow. So it causes the current to flow. Across the junction, and the current will consist of it consists of two components. That is, as I said, the electrons and the holes, right? So electrons are injected from the emitter to the base, and holes are injected from the base into the emitter. So it is highly desirable. So it is highly desirable to have the electrons from the emitter to base, okay? Because emitter base is forward bias to be much larger than the second component, that is the holes from the base to emitter, okay? Base to the emitter, because base is p-type, right? So holes will be the major carriers, okay? So this can be accomplished by fabricating the device with highly doped emitter and lightly doped base. That is, the device is designed to have high density of electrons in the emitter region and low density of holes in the base, okay? This was already discussed in the previous slide, okay? It was already mentioned. So the current from the current that flows across the emitter base junction will constitute the emitter current IE, and the direction of IE is out of the emitter lid. Okay, so as you see in the slide, okay, IE is pointing, it's coming out of the emitter, okay, and which usually follows the usual convention and is in the direction of the positive charge carriers. Or the positive charge flow, hole current, and the opposite of the direction of the negative charge flow, that is the electrons, with the emitter current IE being equal to the sum of the two components. Okay, what are the two components? IC plus IB, right? And since the electron component is much larger than the hole components, the emitter current will be dominated by the electron components. Okay, the current flow across the forward biased PN junction, we know that the magnitude of both the electron component and the hole component of IE will be proportional to. Okay, so what is it proportional to? E is equal to VBE by VT, where VBE is the forward bias voltage across the base emitter junction, and VT is nothing but the thermal voltage. Approximately, the thermal voltage defined at the room temperature of 25, at room temperature is 25 millivolt. Okay, and so the first component, namely the carried by the electrons injected from the emitter to base. Okay, the electrons are injected from emitter to the base region. Okay, this portion. Okay, here. So these electrons are called as the minority carriers, okay, in the p-type base region. So because the their concentration will be highest at the emitter side of the base, so the injected electrons will diffuse through the base region towards the collector some of the electrons will combine with the holes, which are the majority carriers in the base. And since the base is usually very thin, okay, because it is lightly doped, right? The proportion of electrons the proportion of electrons will be lost, okay, due to a recombination process will be quite small. Okay, and then most of the diffusing electrons will reach the boundary of the collector base junction, that is the depletion region. Okay, so because the collector is more positive than the base, because it is collector base is reverse bias, right? And there is VCB. Okay, the voltage is reverse bias voltage is VCB. Thus, the electrons will be swept across the common base junction or the depletion region, common base junction depletion region, into the collector, and they will thus get the current and constitute the collector current. Okay, so they constitute the collector current. Okay, so now let's see how we are representing the DC and AC representation of transistor voltages and current. Okay, so usually the DC quantities always carry an uppercase subscript. For example, IB, IC, IE are the DC transistor currents. Okay, and similarly, the VBE, VCB, VCE represent the DC voltages from one transistor terminal to the other. VB, VC, VE are the DC voltages from the transistor terminal to the ground. Okay. And how we represent the AC is, this is very important when you are writing your analysis. Okay, so you need to keep in mind whenever you are representing DC quantity and AC, how you have to represent them. AC and all time varying quantities always carry a lowercase subscript. For example, IB, IC, IE are the AC transistor currents. VBE, VCB, VCE are the AC voltages from one transistor terminal to the other transistor. That is, VBE is the voltage across base emitter. VCB means voltage across the common, collector base. VCE is the voltage across collector emitter. Okay, and then you have VB, VC, and VE are the AC voltages from the transistor terminal to the ground. Okay, so this is how you represent the DC and the AC, DC and the AC quantities. For the transistor currents and voltages. Okay, so now let's see the BJT current voltage in the active mode. As I said, so we saw in the previous slide that you have, due to the injection of electrons and the holes, you have injected holes in the electrons. You had three current components, that is the emitter current, collector current and the base current. When we also saw that emitter current is the sum of the collector current, and the emitter current was outgoing, whereas collector and the base current was incoming, correct? Right? So if you observe here, this is incoming and this is also going in and this is coming out. So it looks like it is a sum of IB plus IC, right? Yeah. Okay. So BJT operating in active mode provides a collector current which is equivalent to, okay. So when collector current is carried by the electrons that reach the collector region. Okay, so what is collector current? It is the electrons that reach the collector region. So, and its direction will be opposite to that of the flow of electrons, and thus it is into the collector terminal. So, and its magnitude will be proportional to, we saw it is proportional to E into V power VBE by VT. Okay, and thus it can be represented. So, thus collector current can be represented as IC is equal to IS into, okay. IC is equal to IS into e power VBE by VT, where the constant of proportionality IS is the saturation current. We have already seen that in the case of diode, right? And is the transistor and is a transistor parameter, and we will have more, we'll be using this representation throughout, okay, or the this expression throughout, and it is an important observation to make that IC is independent of the value of VCB here. That is, as long as the collector is positive with respect to the base, the electrons that reach the collector side of the base region will be swept into the collector and will register as the collector current. Okay, the second component is the base current, which can also be represented as IC by beta, which is the current gain. Okay, that is equal to IC by beta into. So I can replace IC as IS into e power VBE by VT, and therefore IS can be represented. IB can be re-represented or rewritten as IS e power VBE by VT by beta, where beta is the transistor parameter. And for a modern NPN transistor, beta is in the range of 50 to 200, but it can be as high as 1000 for special devices. And for this reason, it will become clear that the parameter beta is also called as the common emitter current gain. Okay. And it also indicates, or the value of beta is highly influenced by two factors. One is the width of the base region, which is represented as W. Later we will see this. Okay. And relative doping of the base region and the emitter region. Okay. Which is given by NA by ND. And to obtain a high beta, which is highly desirable since beta represents the gain parameter, the base should be thin and it should be lightly doped, and the emitter should be heavily doped. Okay. And so for modern integrated circuit fabrications technology, W is in the range of nanometers. Okay. The width is in the range of nanometers. And then we have the other current component, that is the emitter current. Okay, so since the current that enters a transistor must leave it, it can as seen in the previous slide, the emitter current is equal to, okay, the collector current and the base current, that is IE is equal to IC plus IB. Okay, so if you represent IC as IS e power VBE by VT, then IE is equal to IS e power VBE by VT divided by alpha. Okay, so we need to note that IS is the reverse saturation current, VT is the thermal voltage, alpha is the common base current gain, and beta is the common emitter current gain. Okay, that is beta is the common emitter current gain, alpha is the common base current gain. Okay, and so the emitter current, so the emitter current IE is equal to IB plus IC. So substituting for IB and IC, we can rewrite the expression for the emitter current as 1 plus beta into Is e power VBE by VT divided by beta. Okay. And we can also, the collector current can be also expressed in terms of the gain, the current gain alpha, that is IC is equal to alpha into IE. Beta can be again expressed in terms of alpha as beta is equal to 1 alpha divided by 1 minus alpha. Okay. And that is, so here again, alpha and beta are the transistor parameters. And again, alpha should be less, but very close to 1 or unity. And say, for instance, if beta is 100 and alpha is say 0.09, okay, 0.9, then a small change in alpha will correspond to a very large change in beta. Okay, if you take the expression beta is equal to alpha by 1 minus alpha. Okay, so so the mathematical observations manifest itself physically with the result that the transistor of the same type may have widely different values of beta. For this reason, alpha is called as the common base current gain. Okay. And so with this, we end the second session of the module 1. Let's meet for the third session and let's continue our discussion on how the carrier distribution happens in case of your BJT transistor, and we'll also discuss the profiles of the minority carrier concentration in the base and the emitter for the NPN transistor in the next coming session. Thank you, all of you.